White Rabbit Presents Unfinished Business by Michael Bracewell. Read by Gina Murray. Prologue. I now introduce a black and white photograph taken in the autumn of 1978. The subject is my friend Francesca's boyfriend at that time, name of Martin Knight, with whom, as was her custom, she was briefly infatuated to the exclusion of all else. Francesca, then just turned 18, I was nearly 20, and in the first flush of romance, took the photograph herself. Location, the long overgrown garden of her parents' house in Wimbledon. I recall the happy delight with which she crouched down to focus the camera, changing position to get different angles, and between shots, smiling encouragingly up at her beloved, who was seated, barely daring to breathe, on a precariously flimsy folding garden chair. But love, or luck, imbued the portrait with an undeniable sense of presence. The top button of his white shirt unfastened, this latest bow has loosened what I remember to be an antique silver-grey tie, flecked with pinpoints of pink silk thread. Beneath stylishly cut black hair, his young face is still soft-skinned and smooth-jawed. His nose is straight, and his lips rather too red. The look in his dark brown eyes is watchful and uncertain, almost fierce. In what they hope to be the style of a matinee idol, there is a lighted cigarette between the middle and index fingers of Martin's left hand that rests lightly, thumb on high cheekbone, fingertips just touching his left eyebrow as he inclines his head to one side. Smoke rises in languid coils. It is a successful study of indolent pose, either despite or because of the sitter's self-consciousness, which defined him. Martin was a little younger than me, but seemed much younger. Francesca had told me, protectively I felt, that he wrote poetry. He was eager to please and eager to impress. The way he conducted himself was like a succession of beginnings, hopeful shots at the world that resembled offerings or auditions. 40 years ago, the road ahead seemed to draw us steadily on towards real life. I was glad to get away, and so was Francesca. Not long after that, she left for Russia, adventurous even in those days, and I became a psychiatric nurse. I have no idea what happened to Martin. I don't suppose I'll ever see him again. 1. On an overcast January morning in the year 2017, a man was waiting to cross Cambridge Heath Road. White sky over the interminable sprawl of East London. Behind him, in the cold flat light, the shuttered Venus Sports Bar looked as though it had been locked and empty for years. He was still handsome. His dark hair was silvering at the sides, lending him a mildly distinguished air. He was reasonably but not noticeably tall. His jawline and features had kept their definition. His tired eyes held an expression that was both sorrowful and aloof, wary, perhaps. His name in full was Martin Graham Crispin Knight. He was 57 years old. He was wearing a black overcoat, faded black leather gloves, one of which he was holding in his left hand, and a black scarf. His aging dark suit, black lace-up shoes, white shirt, and nondescript tie pronounced him a lifer in the service of office work. Across the busy junction, he could see the dimly lit entrance to Cambridge Heath Station. The lights changed, and slowly, as though with effort, he started to cross the road. The platform was reached by two steep flights of covered stairs. Martin looked up from the dirty bare subway that was open behind him to the street and morning traffic, and then he began to climb. Such cramping and burning in his legs and feet. like flame-hot iron shoes that tightened with each step. Vascular disease. Claudication. Only walking might improve the condition, while only resting relieved the pain. 20 years ago, he and Marilyn, then still his wife, had taken their seats, quiet and scared, in a white office in a private hospital. The consultant sat sideways to his desk, florid beneath an aristocratic mop of silver hair. "And you must ask yourself," said the great man, "do you prefer smoking to staying alive?" The smartly dressed couple sat very still. "I do not see an unsullied horizon," he went on, studying the file. "You are extremely young." Martin's narrowed aorta was reopened. He gave up smoking, eventually. It had felt like the end of his youth. With compromised arteries, he struggled visibly on his commute. Forced to pause, he would watch busy women hurrying to work, and men, 2 decades his junior, lean and focused, striding towards their day. Now, holding onto the banister, he hauled himself up the stairs to the platform. Finally, he reached the top, breathless, his legs hurting. But immediately the air seemed fresher and the daylight brighter. An immense vista surrounded him. He was filled with a sense of calm. This was his favorite part of the day. He often recalled how not so long ago, this whole area, Dalston, Kingsland Road, Mare Street, Hackney Central, had been desolate, haunted equally by boredom, poverty, and menace. Melancholy parades of decrepit shops, wire mesh nailed over their windows, broad, apathetically littered streets eerily empty. Murder Mile. Rotting old picture palaces and deserted parks. Silent estates, a few Victorian churches of extravagant design, mostly shut and shabby. The elevated stretch of the line ran straight from Liverpool Street, just a few minutes away, through Bethnal Green and Cambridge Heath. Most weekday mornings watched over by blocks of new apartments with neat balconies and windswept roof terraces. Martin surveyed the changing landscape. The latest flats with their big windows, a glimpse within of brushed metal worktops and pale wooden furnishings. To one side, a long abandoned warehouse open to the sky. The weathered red brick was crumbling, sprouting scrawny shrubs. It was like a middle distant future, quiet and grey. But even what, 10, 15 years ago, in the lobby of the 21st century, which did not feel like his century, would you stand up here alone? At any time of day? Or 37 years ago? York Hall Baths, Old Ford Road. Martin walked to the low bench and sat down more heavily than he had expected. He was alone, he noticed, at 9:07 on that chill midwinter morning, aware of the pain subsiding in his legs, the working day to get through, and the vast white sky. It had been like this for the last few years, his job and rented flat. He had left the rooms rather bare but liked the view from the long kitchen window. So many summers and sunsets, fleeting epiphanies, a marriage, working weeks, familiar streets, resentments, sudden panics, regrets, nurtured desires, all slipping slowly away, almost as though they had never happened. Just his daughter Chloe, and she was in her 20s now, dark-haired, pretty, living her own life. He felt a sudden swell in his sea of tranquility. For recently, he fancied, he had become aware of an overview, a symptom of age, no doubt. His life presented to him as though by destiny, with an unnerving, and unexpected shrug. There you go then. Dismissive, final. So he reminded himself that there had been births and deaths, loss and love. A life of everything and nothing during the 6 decades since he had opened his eyes to asphalt. Beyond the suburbs of his boyhood, built to follow the railway lines, had arisen shopping, television, pop, debt, aerobics, irony, computers, phones and coffee shops that looked like Prohibition-era grain stores. Then bigger things, climate change, terrorism, that always seemed far away. Like the suburbs, Martin had grown in step with the London railway network, his earliest adulthood spent in the old commuting world of overhead wires and grey metal gantries, humming cables and black-oiled tracks, damp waiting rooms that smelt of gas, broken windows, and empty subways. Against such a backdrop, he had sought first beauty and then love. To him, they were the same thing. Now, this cold morning, he would take a train to Liverpool Street to go to work. He sat with his legs stretched out. He had got heavier, the thickening process of late middle age. "So manly," an American woman visiting the office had said. Women still found him attractive. "You've lived," one had said not so long ago, mockingly to flirt. Behind him, in pale silhouette, Canary Wharf, the plain blocks of dust-grey towers, to the right, closer, the glinting curves, cones, and rhomboid shapes of the city. Some clouds had parted, revealing the pale disk of the low winter sun. Standing, Martin could see back streets and a bus depot. Further off, the exposed concrete stairwells on the side of some flats, a Somali drop-in centre with crazily punched security glass. In a broadsheet supplement interview some months earlier, the subject, an ageing French fashion designer, had been asked, "Your greatest regret?" and responded, "Nicotine." Martin had noted the answer and felt buoyed for a second. There was a satisfaction in searching through Time's files for the start of his addiction to cigarettes. For that, in many ways, had been the start of everything. It had begun one quiet afternoon when he was 15 years old, at home in Thornby Avenue, kneeling in front of the sitting room fireplace. In his mind's eye, he saw the smooth black tiles of the hearth, dotted with soot, the brass claw fire tongs and sabre-handled poker, the elongated decorative bricks around. It was a late spring day, almost summer. The fire was not laid. Rain had brought the soot down. His father was still alive, and then he had smoked his first cigarette. But how could such a significant event have occurred so quietly? He had been with a school friend who was hesitant and slightly disgusted. For Martin, the love affair with tobacco had been immediate and all-consuming. Cigarettes, he believed, gave confidence, enlightenment, and more. Smoking was the enabler of pose and emblem of the aphoristic life, worldly glamour, rebel attitude. What next in the old files from memory's cavernous registry? To Tiles, a boarding school for boys in Kent. In those days, 1975-76, during the summer holidays, Martin would select a day or wake inspired, dress in his best clothes, and wait in warm sunshine for the heavy, acrid-smelling suburban train. Slam doors and luggage racks of knotted string netting. With a carnation in his buttonhole, he would travel up to London to do 3 things. First, to walk down Piccadilly, past the Ritz, the Burlington Arcade, the Royal Academy, Fortnum & Mason and Simpsons, to 34 Haymarket. Here, stood a Georgian double bow-fronted shop, historically for nobility and gentry. Fribourg and Treia, manufacturers of snuff and purveyors of tobacco products. Number One Filter Deluxe was Martin's preferred brand, sold in a flat box of dove grey card, embossed with black and gold. Came a humid afternoon around that time when Martin would watch entranced as lovely Fenella, a teenage brunette Monroe to him, his first love, painfully unrequited, weighed the pleasingly heavy box in her soft young palm, then held it up, admiring it. They were sitting on the patio at his childhood friend Christine's house. The heat-heavy garden, the neatly mown lawn before them. Second, tea for one at the Ritz Palm Court. Young Martin, with his broad-lapelled, checked sports jacket, oyster beige, Oxford bags, fat-knotted, satin-style copper-gold tie, silver cigarette case, and amber cigarette holder, had been led to his table with utmost seriousness by the tall, rigidly dignified maître d'hôtel. Framed by mirrors, gilt, and marble, the young aesthete had ordered Darjeeling tea, lit a cigarette, and imbibed his setting like a drug. And thirdly, to stroll to the dim-lit bar of the Café Royal and order there the cocktail of champagne and blue curacao, upon the surface of which floated a single scarlet rose petal. Name, redolent of the times, suggestion of something special. The barman had liked him, overlooked his age, and played up to the game of his pose as one of the indolent elect. Fed plenty of sirs and flattering attention, the teenage boulevardier had felt sure that the enfolding shadowy bar was his rightful milieu, the suburbs far off and in those circumstances unmentionable, unthinkable even. Cigarettes had bound that world together and deepened its allure, were its communion and manifesto. Egyptian flats, Turkish, jasmine-scented, Virginia numbers 1 and 2, Sullivan and Powell, Sobrani cocktail, French Bouillards, soft pack Pall Mall, and Russian even, Cossack brand, a short charge of bitter black tobacco packed in diaphanous tissue at the end of a coarse cardboard tube. Cigarettes from the days of Imperial Europe and exotic Asia. Smoking had offered a home, an aesthete's retreat, even back at Tiles. Martin, on the elevated platform, saw again winter daylight, the old school changing room's wooden floor, sodden with decades of water and mud, pitted by a century of boot studs. This was where the smokers smoked. He had been one of two ostentatious smokers with their arcane brands and snow-white shirt collars, their cigarettes held just so to enable an insolently exquisite drag and pout. One day, very early on, 1973-74, Martin had happened to glimpse into one of the small senior studies on the ground floor of a cold and gloomy boarding house. It was late afternoon, wintry and bleak, a foreboding bank of gunmetal cloud pressed down on the line of white gold sunset, far off on the horizon. In the study were two sixth form boys, their dullish thick brown hair worn as long and unkempt as possible. One wore a naval greatcoat over his uniform, fully buttoned. The other, stock still, was dressed in a three-piece college suit of grey serge, a broad black and white scarf around his neck. Looking more carefully posed than casually seated, one in the wreckage of an armchair, both were staring silently ahead, seemingly at nothing, as though in a trance, and both were smoking, unblinking, with exaggerated refinement. each held his cigarette pushed down low between the index and middle fingers of the left hand, which was then brought gently to the left corner of the mouth. Inhale briefly with lips slightly parted, then pull the cigarette away from the mouth in a single staccato gesture, an abbreviated flick to the side. Exhale as though blowing lightly but sharply on a candle flame. Behind them, in the fading light, to the height of the ceiling, was an uninterrupted collage of overlapping posters. Dirty Harry, a cartoon cat with swastika eyes, Jimi Hendrix, a bare-breasted ash-blonde girl, hand on hip, denim hot pants, her accessories a beaded headband and automatic rifle. From a brace of homemade speakers, impressively loud, the mothers of invention accompanied the falling dusk. Unnoticed, Martin had been in awe of it all. A little over a decade later, when he and Marilyn were taking his books out of cardboard boxes, their move to Bristol, she had looked in horror at the smoke-stained covers. The King of Elfland's Daughter, Catch 22, Lolita, The Colour of Tobacco Juice. Marilyn, to Martin, had been defined by fragrant cleanliness, pristine, unblemished, a trace of fern, bergamot, iris. He recalled a snowy night in January 1984. The interior of Marilyn's smart black car had been filled with her lightly metallic floral perfume. To Martin, it was the scent of sophistication and the modern life. This was their first journey together, the drive from Chiswick to Vauxhall, to Martin's first flat. Everywhere so quiet, a little after midnight, with freshly fallen snow, the shadowy bulks of tall dark buildings passing by. It was as though they had the dimly luminous silent streets, the whole of London, to themselves. How she had enchanted him with her reserve, her seemingly cool pragmatism. Now everything was wrong. Perhaps it had only needed one false step. In doing so badly at school, for instance, flailing in fervent adolescence. Had those exchanged confessions with Christine 40 years ago, her teenage bedroom a shrine to romance, Mooka Prince and Donna Summer, their pursuit of the new and confrontationally flamboyant, of heeding the call of heightened emotion above all, urged him down the wrong path completely? His commonplace talents, mathematics, doing well in interviews for jobs, were, he felt, so at odds with his soul. He was a poet manqué, he had told himself. From that, clearly, all else proceeded. After the divorce, and that was 14 years ago now, Martin used to meet Stuart for dinner. They had known one another in the old days. Stuart was the former boyfriend of a school friend of Marilyn's called Catherine. In fact, Martin had first met Marilyn at Catherine's flat in Chiswick. "Nowadays, we'd call it depression," Stuart had said about Catherine's sudden silences. The two men would go to a busy fish restaurant in the shadow of Southwark Cathedral. Here, there was an exposed kitchen, fierce heat, sudden bursts of flame and noisy sizzling. The clamorous din of a newly opened brasserie. Chefs chucked halved lobsters onto spitting sheets of hot oil. Muscular renegade cooking was in fashion. Handfuls of salt, coarse ground nuggets of black pepper, huge fistful squeezings of lemon and lime. More sizzling, lobster and chips with tamarind aioli. Martin had watched the things still twitching. "It's the kind of place," he had remarked to Stuart, "where you have to be drunk already." Stuart had caught the waitress's eye and with a meaningful glance raised the bottle an inch. "Same again," she smiled, defining an epoch. Good-natured Stuart had married an alcoholic psychotherapist in Roehampton, but was now separated again. I never knew a relationship counsellor who could throw up in the bath during a dinner party. Classic. He had been a good drinking companion, quick to laugh, reserved yet amusing. Plump, owlish, he wore glasses with thick black frames. Sometimes he laughed so readily that Martin wondered whether he was simply very naive. Then Stuart disappeared, joined AA, went daily to meetings in a crypt on Bishopsgate, packed every one of them. And Martin had walked the cold street from Bank Station up towards Moorgate alone. He had sat on a bench near the Royal Exchange, leaning forward with his arms crossed tightly over his chest, rocking and blissful. A wonderful gale was blowing in his head. It was most important to get another drink. Then, suddenly, the thought of religion had seemed ineffably brilliant and moving to him. He imagined Oxford, Gothic Revival, a Christmas tree decked with playing cards. And suppose he had got there, to Oxford, as he was meant to at Tiles. But Fenella had taken him to South Kensington one warm summer evening, all the way from Thornby Avenue, and innocently corrupted him, utterly without guile. In less than an hour, she had shown him a world beyond the suburbs, beyond the ambitions he had lived with thus far. He saw it through the big windows of Onslow Square drawing rooms. The low-shaded lamps and lazily extravagant cushions and Italian light fittings and significant paintings over the fireplace. Scarlet brake lights flared softly in the blue Chelsea dusk. It was like a midsummer magic, busily at work in the heady, fragrant air. And then he had to go all the way home again. Decades later, in a pizza restaurant, alone, finishing a bottle of Chianti, he imagined the other life. My Oxford years. Autumnal mists, moisture on high, flinty walls, candle-lit medieval windows, deer parks, choristers, blossom, evensong, and cloisters. Dust-filled sunbeams falling on ancient volumes. Modest yet confident young men, intellectually well-bred. Girls of rare intensity from tumble-down aristocratic homes, part muse, part siren. And they would all have had fine minds. That is, be able to order knowledge neatly and efficiently. And then be able to walk across Iraq, or similar, fine-mindedly, finding meaning and interest in a way that, above all, their fine-minded elders would approve of. Which, being in a world of his own, Martin could never do. He knew that he not only lacked the right qualities, but repelled those who had them. Now, where had he seen that exact same expression of sudden disgust before? Yes, on the face of the friend by the hearth, with their first cigarette each. Not just the taste, but the act. The two things that Martin had found so intoxicating. Warm in the arms of alcohol, London Wall, at the pizza restaurant they had up there. Glass walls straddling the road. You could just sit by the window, above the traffic, surrounded by towers of concrete and glass, ice blue lit but deserted, and drink Chianti by yourself and get drunk, and see meaning and poetry in every dark city doorway. And now Martin was on the platform awaiting the 9:27. This had been his favourite part of the day. Everything and nothing. The avenues of plane trees at London Fields and Hackney Downs. His life these days was circumscribed by the long streets with their little supermarkets, closed-down security firms, artisan coffee shops, weird conversions, steep steps up to big old houses, pristine new apartments, race-walking junkies, and aging estates. Still, the Victorian churches were there. The missions and institutes, their mouldering walls topped with barbed wire and broken glass, some now with cosmically liturgical names. And young families he would never know, susceptible to allergens and dust and gluten, bearded dad and busy mum, their bikes, kids, coffee and computers. How was it possible that he, Martin Knight, of Cambridge Heath Station and Hackney Central, had once lived in Bristol? The flapjack years. That had been his post-divorce joke about provincial life. But even now, sometimes, if by chance, he remembered somewhere quite ordinary they used to visit there, he would feel ashamed and filled with sadness. August 1989.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.